علمت أن الآخرة لا بد يوما آتية كل الخلائق.
So the Muslim shouldn't fall into this shallow understanding. I don't have the dunya. I have no possession of this dunya. And what do these people possess? This world is nothing in comparison to the akhirah, except for dip your finger in an ocean. So let you see what clings to your finger. One dip. And that ocean is paradise. That small dip that we rejoice in on a daily basis. فَاتَّقُ الدُّنْيَا. This world is a lush green place. Thus the Prophet Muhammad said, فَاتَّقُ الدُّنْيَا. Fear this world. وَاتَّقُ النِّسَا. And fear the fitna of women. فَاتَّقُ الدُّنْيَا. Why should you fear this world? Because this world will overtake you. Take your mind away from the path towards the Akhirah. And the mu'min sees through this dunya. And this has been narrated about the Isra wal Mi'raj, that the dunya appeared to the Prophet Muhammad as an old woman with grey hair. Beauty has been taken away from her. There's nothing left. That is the parable of this dunya. With all respect to our respected sisters, but an old woman, nothing is left. That's the perception of this dunya. How did he see this dunya? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Kun dunya, kun fi dunya ka annaka gharib wa abiru sabeel. Be in this dunya as a stranger, or as a wayfarer, as a traveler. How many of us have heard this hadith on so many occasions? Are we ghuraba in the dunya at the moment? Are we strangers? Do we feel like strangers? Do we feel like wayfarers and travelers in this dunya? A traveler only stops in the shade. Mali wa mali dunya. What is my relationship with this dunya? Except for a traveler who stops and rests underneath a shade. Al-hadith ma rawahu Imam Ahmad fi musnadihi. And likewise we find Umar ibn al-Khattab رضي الله تعالى عنه. That in the dunya had been exposed to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, the wealth and the possessions of this dunya. Umar ibn Khattab enters into the house or into the hujra of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and sees him lying on a reed mat, a mat made from palm leaves. Try it someday to lie down on straw put together. And you'll feel it would scar your body, leave marks on your feet for those people who prayed on the straw mat. Umar begins to cry and says, look at the leaders of the dunya and what they possess and what they own. And you lie on a mat like this. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What does he state? Leave these people alone. Mali wa mali dunya. What is with me and the dunya? I have nothing to do with this dunya. Inna mathali ka rakib. I'm only a traveler who travels through this dunya and takes shade underneath the tree and then rides his beast again and continues again.
آمنت أن الآخرة لا بد يوما آتية كل الخلائق حاضرة كل السرائر.
I have thought about how to describe Jannah to you, and I'm sure there are 101 cassettes out there talking about Jannah and its beautiful things. Every one of them will be better than my talk today. However, I thought and I pondered, how will I give you a beautiful taste of exactly how beautiful Jannah will truly be? And I could not find anything better to have this talk about Jannah except the poem of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah about Wasf al-Jannah, about the description of Jannah. And that is Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah's poem An-Nuniyah, which is Nuniyah because it, every single verse, as you will see, ends with a noon. Every single verse of poetry ends with a noon. And it is so full of beauty. I wanted to share the Wasf al-Jannah, the description of paradise, from this poem of An-Nuniyah to you today. Nuniyah is thousands of verses of poetry about the Aqidah of Islam, about the belief of a Muslim, about Allah and the Akhirah, about Iman, Qadr, etc., etc. What I have done over here is I have chosen segments of An-Nuniyah, compiled it together, not always according to the correct tarteeb or the correct order that Ibn Qayyim has done. However, I've done it in an order which is logical, inshallah, so that you can follow and listen to what this great Imam and how he describes Jannah, and at the end he goes mad. He literally goes mad. He literally goes mad describing Jannah because of its beauty and the beauty of its women and the beauty of its life. SubhanAllah, let me share this with you today. And so what I will do, inshallah, is I will read the section, the segments in Arabic, and then I will explain what it means in English. So listen to me attentively.
So the Prophet told us about the situation, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. This hadith is no doubt talking about this time, but it also happened, something similar to it, during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When all of the Arabs came together against the companions, how did they respond to it? In the battle of Al-Khandaq, Al-Ahzab. Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمَ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. All of the Arabs came together against the Muslims to extinguish the light of Al-Islam. So some of the Munafiqeen came to the Muslims and said, hey, look, all of the Arabs, all of the Arabs of the Arabian Peninsula, they have gathered together against you. So fear them, be afraid of them. The companions, as Allah mentioned in the Quran, that statement didn't do anything, but it caused their iman to increase. And they said, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Allah is enough for us, and Allah is a good, blessed wakil. وَلَمَّا رَأَى الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابِ قَالُوا هَذَا مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَصَدَقَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَمَا زَادَهُمْ إِلَّا إِيمَانًا وَتَسْلِيمًا. When the Muslims saw the Ahzab, they said, hey, this is what Allah and His Messenger promised us. He told us this was going to happen. And Allah and His Messenger spoke the truth. And that sight of the enemy in those large numbers did nothing but increase them in iman and submission.